First of all, again, thanks for the invite. These are my disclosures. I'm a surgeon by profession, but I work a lot in the transcatheter field. The other disclosure is TR. We have a valve clinic which we run on Mondays and Wednesdays, and one of our fellows last year stuck a paper saying, "I hate TR," and I was wondering why. And then when we analyzed our number of patients we see per year, there are at least 250 plus now per year, and these are just patients with TR sent to valve clinic. These are not the patients who are sent to surgeons directly, which is also my other practice. So these are the patients, 150, but we don't have good solutions for these 150. And that's why I think we do so many investigations, so much effort is put in, and we don't have really good solutions. So hopefully I'll highlight what new solutions are coming through into clinical field. There are other challenges as well, and I really enjoyed the morning session on heart failure, and we are collaborating more and more with the heart failure side now to understand the not only thinking process, but management issues and real life scenarios. So first of all, TR always presents as really vague symptoms. Regurgitation, as we know, is extremely dynamic. We had great discussion on value of echo, MR. It's actually poorly defined in tricuspid. Forget heart failure and mitral side. Volume overload is well tolerated. These patients are all on diuretics. They're managed quite well. Most of the time, if you ask them, fatigue is the main symptom, and some of the logistic problems in day-to-day life. The other biggest issue is the appeal of surgical therapy is less, and probably all of you, especially we as surgeons, hear it all the time. Tricuspid surgery is bad, tricuspid surgery is bad, 17 to 20% mortality. But let's remember that most of these patients have had previous cardiac intervention. Very rarely we operate just on isolated tricuspid. So a lot of this high mortality which is quoted is because the patients are sick to start with. And I think there is still a lot of variation or understanding of, like in mitral we use mild, moderate, severe. I think in TR it could be probably a bit more than that, and I'm going to touch base on that a bit later. So this is a classic patient we get in Colombia. I moved from London, I practiced there for 18 years. I would never see this patient in NHS, but every patient who walks here is either on a wheelchair or a walker or a oxygen, and the first 3 months were very traumatic for me. Forget the patient. So this is a classic 92-year-old who wants to live till 100. And to be honest, she is our poster child for this therapy. She did actually very well in the end. But look at the symptoms, same thing. You know, she has been following up for severe TR. There's no acute decompensation, one or two admissions here and there. Some patients do present many times with hospital admissions where they get ascitic taps and they feel better symptomatically and then they're back into the community. When we looked at it, she had hepatomegaly as well. She had peripheral edema. Past history as expected at that age probably. Other than that, she has had a CABG in 1992. You can see that she has multiple problems. So I would definitely say that this is not a surgical candidate, and probably Joe, you would agree with me, that you would definitely, this patient will, these are sent by heart failure colleagues. So we are trying to think of what can we do now to improve quality of life. Her TR, just to highlight, just to show you that there's a really wide coaptation gap, and those of you who are more familiar with 3D echoes can see that the annular area and the dimensions are dilated. We work with Becky Hahn and Omar Kaliki, who are absolutely excellent imaging specialists. So they just don't write severe TR. They give you many numbers. Just to simplify all these different numbers, it essentially means it's a torrential TR. So this patient is classic, has a wide coaptation gap, has got really torrential TR. This is an article published by the first author is Becky Hahn, who I work with, and as you can see that the effort was, I would say, a bit of therapy driven, So it's not mild, moderate TR. It's massive and torrential as well. And I'll tell you the reason behind this. When we do surgery, our aim is to get anything from whatever it is, severe plus, to zero, whether it's mitral or whether it's tricuspid or aortic. After mitral clip came in, our thinking had changed, whether you can reduce severe MR to mild to moderate MR, and is it okay with the patient. On TR side, this became a bigger issue because even if you did some intervention treatment, and I'm going to show you a couple of them, is that this torrential would reduce up to severe, and that's considered as failure of treatment. But clinically, you can see a lot of these patients actually benefiting in many ways, such as reduction in their diuretics, reduction in their renovascular venous hypertension. And these are the indirect benefits, and that's this article makes an effort into differentiating severe from severe, massive, and torrential. So as usual, surgery, as I said, probably not suitable for this one, but if we did some kind of surgery, today it's become more simplified. We would either replace this valve, nobody's going to try and repair this valve if you open this patient. But if you did a repair, it could be some kind of a ring-based repair rather than the suture-based repairs. But the reason to show this is what exactly we are trying to do with percutaneous approaches. All these percutaneous approaches, most of them are based on something or the other practiced by surgeons from 1960s. For example, we used a suture annuloplasty. Now we try and do something similar with cardioband. We will do this clover technique, which is essentially like a mitral clip you put between two leaflets, and so on and so forth. We can divide this therapy in many things which you can use on annulus, things which you can use on leaflet. You can use some valves in a very funny position, and of course, the replacement part. Very quickly, one therapy which we have used, this company has shut down now, but it's called as bicuspidization. So essentially, you just cinch the annulus down and make it smaller. Cardioband is probably more easy to understand. You put a band or a ring around the annulus, onto the annulus, and then you cinch the whole annulus down so as to make the leaflets co-op better. You have got some other concepts of deforming the annulus rather than cinching it so that two leaflets can come nearer and co-op. And lastly, but not the least, the most out of box probably is a spacer. So if there is a gap, just fill it with a balloon-like or a foam-like structure so that the leaflets now co-opt to this foam and reduce the TR. Of course, there are many other challenges in these kinds of therapy. And lastly, but not the least, is the mitral clip, which we have seen now in the first presentation. You can also use in tricuspid, but of course, more challenging. And then now Pascal device, which is being currently studied, which is manufactured by Edwards. And lastly, but not the least, very innovative things is forget TR, just put some stents and valves, TAVR devices, or purpose-made devices into SVC, IVC, so you can reduce the preload. Very quickly, what I'm going to show now is what we did in this case. So this case, we decided that we're going to, none of those other out-of-box concepts are going to work very well. So we decided we are going to use a transcatheter valve. This is manufactured by a Navigate company. This is essentially driven part from Cleveland Clinic. They had done two cases before. They had some strange experiences with that. I'm going to show you why. The first thing is all these new devices come with a really very primitive delivery system. What you see in TAVR is not what we saw 15 years ago. 15 years ago, transapical or transfemoral TAVR was much more adventurous, fun, and in many ways intriguing. But this is exactly what's happening in this field now. Whatever we get today, despite our 15 years experience in mitral clip and TAVR, is still not very refined. So the first challenge, the two cases were attempted through transjugular approach. The first challenge is, as you saw, the device is very big. So when you crimp it down, it's still going to be very big. So this is like, I would say, a 2-centimeter delivery system, which is quite big in my view. So to put it through transjugular became a problem. And once they got through the transjugular, the issue comes is this, that the tricuspid plane is here, and you inserted the delivery system, if you can see the arrow here, like that. But when you pull it to position, you actually pull upwards and not towards the lateral part of the atrium. And that tilts the device, and that led to some issues in the first two cases. And this is exactly the vector I'm trying to show you. So what we thought is, let's keep this simple. This is already a 90-plus-year-old patient. Let's do it transatrial. So this is, we took a small incision, as we surgeons do for minimally invasive mitral, and you actually don't need anything. You just make a small bursting in the atrium, and then you do the procedure through that. Of course, we do CT planning in terms of size of the device, access point, and you can see that, of course, we confirm that with intracardiac echo. But more importantly, what we do is we do something really basic. Those of you who have been involved in TMVR will remember what is known as the finger poke test. And the finger poke test is you essentially just poke your finger and look at the echo, and you get the best site for a puncture because you want to be perpendicular to the plane. This is what we do again in this as well. You can see I've placed an instrument, radio opaque instrument here to understand what my distance is going to be. You require around 5 centimeters from the annulus, and then we are going to proceed with the procedure. You can see again here, this is the finger poke test which I was telling you about. You can see the tricuspid valve here. So we look at both explants and see that it's relatively straightforward. You can tolerate around 15% of deviation from perpendicular view. The first case, which was this one, what we did was we put a pigtail through the groin, did some injection to just make sure that our guide wires and all are in good position. You can see then the delivery sheath was inserted here. And then look at the size of the delivery sheath. It's bigger than the TE probe. So these are not small delivery systems. And that's the reason I was very worried doing this through transjugular approach. Centering the device is important. As you know, these devices are not retrievable. That means once you start deploying it, you have to commit to it. And this is why we make a slight more effort to understand essentially what these complex echoes are showing is that we are as central as possible. You don't want to be more biased in the septal or otherwise. You can see now the device is being deployed. One of the interesting things or differentiation from RV and LV is that RV is so good, you can have a moderator band, and one of these tines can get caught into moderator band, and then the procedure is over. So you have to be very careful in terms of deploying this device and positioning it. You can see that this device is now being released. One of the bigger problems with such devices is that they go from a very small diameter to a complete big diameter so they can jump at that time. As you know, that this valve was like 5 centimeter diameter. So from a 2 centimeter, suddenly it's going to become 5 centimeter. But to my biggest surprise, in this first case, what impressed me best was this. Look at the angio. This patient had no TR. As soon as I finished the case, actually took a picture and sent to Craig Smith, who is our chair. And Craig was like, wow, this is really good. And this, what impressed us, was the most thing. One thing you can see here is another critical point in treating TR. The RV is not bad. We think that if we completely eliminate TR, and it's a poor RV to start with, that's not a very good strategy either. So again, I think we are still learning a lot in terms of elimination is better or reduction is better, especially on the right ventricular side. And we have initiated a study on RV pressure loops, et cetera, with our heart failure guys to study this. Just the last slide. The intraoperative and postoperative course can be varied. We have done now 6 patients after this and 2 more patients with other devices. There are always some issues. It's a reop, there can be adhesions, there can be bleeding. We are worried about thrombosis of these big valves, so we anticoagulate them, and that can lead to chest wall bleeding. So it becomes sometimes a bit complex. RV management is very important as well. And we have had a very good experience with 8 patients now totally done, with only 1 died within 30 days. And this device at present is only available in certain centers on compassionate use protocol. And I think EF early feasibility study should start soon. Thank you very much.